pretrial discovery. Of this litigation in a just, speedy, and inexpensive manner, that's a laugh, the parties are directed to attempt to reach agreement on stipulated facts prior to February 27th, so that the discovery may be limited to those issues which are actually in dispute. Well, is this February 27th, 1996, or 1997, or maybe 2000 year? Oh, speaking of 2000, I have just completed my 2000th program, my 2000th public access program. Isn't that amazing? And then I'm going to have an open house on leap year on February 29th. So you call the number on the screen to find out about it. Announcements. I'm going to tell you about Marilyn said to Herbert, "Aren't you ashamed of yourself going up to that buffet table 9 times?" And he says, "Oh, no, dear, I keep telling him it's for you." And Bob said to Elaine, "When are you thinking of getting married?" And Elaine said, "Constantly." And an archaeologist is the best husband you can have, folks. The older his wife gets, the more interested he gets in her. And Bill got married so late in life that Medicare picked up 80% of the honeymoon. For the happy book, be sure and leave your number, your telephone number, because the address and the name and the zip code do not come clearly through the telephone answering machine unless the person has exceptionally good diction. And so we need your number to call you up to check on the address. And you folks out in Nassau County, if you know anybody who knows anything about cablevision, and who took the program off of the TV 2 years ago, and what political person urged them or even coerced them to do it, you call me. We're going to go out there and we're going to picket in front of cablevision and have to hand out flyers, and we want inside information, and their name will never be used. This is nice. Let me show you this. This is the New York Law Journal, and this appeared on Monday, August 14th, 1996. It's by Elena Sassauer. Here, returned by the post office because the addresses are not clear over the telephone answering machine. So let me read you what Elena Ruth Sassauer wrote. Your front page article, "Funding Cuts Seen Curbing Disciplining of Judges," New York Law Journal, August 1st, quotes the chairman of the New York State Commission on Judicial Conduct, that bum, as saying that budget cuts are compromising the commission's ability to carry out its constitutional mandate. Well, that mandate delineated in Article 2A of the judiciary laws to investigate each complaint against judges and judicial candidates, the only exception being where the commission determines that the complaint on its face lacks merit. 844.1. Yet long ago, in the very period when your article shows the commission had more than ample resources and indeed was therefore requesting less funding, the commission had jettisoned such investigative mandate by promulgating a rule 22 New York CRR 87000.3, converting its mandatory duty to an optional one so that unbounded by any standard and without investigation, it could arbitrarily dismiss judicial misconduct complaints. Yeah. The unconstitutional result of such rule, which as written cannot be reconciled with the statute, is that by the commission's own statistics, it dismisses without investigation over 100 complaints a month. You know those foolish form letters I've been reading you for 4 years?
Yeah.
By Lee Kiclear. And then the next stupid form letter you get is from Albert B. Lawrence up in Albany. For years, the commission has been accused of going over other after small town justices to the virtual exclusion of those sitting on this state's higher courts, particularly Westchester County, New York Supreme Court. Yet, until now, the confidentiality of the commission's procedures has prevented researchers and the media from glimpsing the kind of facially meritorious complaints the commission dismisses and the protectionism it practices when the complained of judge is powerful and politically connected. Hooray for you, Elena. However, the Center for Judicial Accountability Incorporated, a not-for-profit, nonpartisan citizens organization of duplicate copies of such complaint, has been developing an archive of duplicate copies of such complaints. This is a good organization for you to volunteer for. The Commission for Judicial Accountability. Put the number up on the screen, please. Earlier this year, we undertook a constitutional challenge to the Commission's self-promulgated rule as written and applied. Our Article 78 petition annexed copies of each of 8 facially meritorious complaints against high-ranking judges filed with the Commission since 1989, all summarily dismissed by the Commission, with no finding that the complaints were facially without merit. I was an intervener on that lawsuit. In round one of the litigation, Manhattan Supreme Court Justice Herman Kahn, dismissed the Article 78 proceeding in a decision reported on the second front page of the July 31st Law Journal and reprinted in full. By his decision, Justice Kahn, ignoring the fact that the commission was in default, held the commission's self-promulgated rule constitutional. He did this by ignoring the commission's own explicit definition of the term, quote-unquote, investigation, and by advancing an argument never put forward by the commission. As to the unconstitutionality of the rule, as applied, demonstrated by the commission's summary dismissals of the 8 facially meritorious complaints, Justice Kahn held, without any law to support such ruling, and by misrepresenting the factual record before him, that, quote, the issue is not before the court, unquote. The public and legal community are encouraged to access the papers in the Article 78 proceeding from the New York County Clerk's Office, Sassauer versus Commission, number 95-109-141, including the many motions by citizen interveners. C'est moi. What those papers unmistakably show is that the commission protects judges from the consequences of their judicial misconduct and in turn is protected by them. Amen. So be it. Now, here is another article from the New York Law Journal, and I will read you that one next week. Stay tuned. Volunteer at the commission at the Center for Judicial Accountability. And here is a new publication, too, that I will try to read to you next week. I like what Americans for a Better American says about the failure of the courts. One should be able to go to the courthouse and on a plain piece of paper state one's problem. Any forms required should be supplied. Justice can be immediate. Wasting time only serves to justify incompetence. Justice must also be given at little or no cost. And what do we got today? Not out of the public's reach. Currently, justice is a function of connections, quote-unquote, too often limited to the wealthy and to those within the system who can manipulate it in their favor and how. It's a closed system functioning as an entire industry in and of itself. So true. Decisions are often based on what is most beneficial to lawyers and judges, with judges being business agents for lawyers, O&D, and lawyers supporting these judges, all at the expense of and detriment to the public. This is judicial corruption. More next week. Oh, I'm going to read you some of this. This is an excellent letter. This is by Ron Pure. And he's a public access producer. Outrage, as are the rest of us, by TCI robbing our public access rights. That would be John C. Malone, Magnus, TCI, Wicker. There's about 17 defendants in that suit. Your Honor, I was present Tuesday, January 23rd, while the above matter was heard. Unfortunately, I must rely on recall, as you didn't allow electronic recording and were unable to provide in timely fashion a court-appointed recorder for the session. This circumstance prompts a reminder, the one about the erosion of America's confidence in the government and justice system. The following will hopefully expand your view of the deficiency of the TCI's defense and amplify the harm inflicted on the claimant and public. Attorney suggested that TCI would grant up to $4 million sans franchise fee, thus enabling municipalities to provide public access programming capacity and production facilities. Yet no written substantiation was submitted reflecting details of past, present, and future payments to towns. I didn't see any canceled checks. Also absent and of interest for comparison was a history of all costs incurred by TCI to operate the present systematic public access Channel 8. Good thinking, Ron. The grant money, I'm told, is limited to paying for, on a one-time basis, capital items, cameras, lights, editing equipment. If that is so, taxpayers will be expected to forfeit some, all, or more than the revenue derived by municipalities from franchise fees, aka tax. Make no mistake, towns will be responsible to pay for public access employees' operating costs in addition for eventual repair, upgrades, and replacement equipment. Very intelligent letter, Ron. Like it or not, taxpayers are already burdened with the duty to pay for public broadcasting system. Through a crazy quilt of government funding, taxpayers ante up nearly 40% of the PBS annual budget. Why should taxpayers also assume a tax liability for public access when it's typically 100% paid for by cable companies? As it was received a week before Christmas, some think the TCI letter sent to access producers is sort of a season's greetings from Scrooge. A copy is enclosed. Please note, TCI's proposed dismantling of system-wide 8 was processed by no public hearing, no 6 months notice legally required, no courtesy, and little or no kind consideration for the public at large and public access producers. Good points, Ron. I'll read you some more next week. Here's the release sent out by TCR on Friday. February, let's see, 26. And they knew long before that. They knew that afternoon, after the court session, you know, they knew that they couldn't get away with this and that they had to capitulate and they had to withdraw their 30 to 60 day ultimatum. This is a chat with Glendora and young man said to the city clerk, how much does it cost to get married? And city clerk said it costs $20 for the license and one paycheck every week the rest of your life. And Bill says now that he's married, he can see why they call English the mother tongue. Father never gets a chance to use it. And you know why Bill likes to play his wedding videotape backwards? So he can see himself walk out of church a free man. I want to tell you folks and remind you folks how lucky we are to have a government that gives us a federal judiciary center, federal judicial center. Here is the 1995 catalog of their publications, and they have all of these great publications to tell you about the courts. They have books on settlement, they have books on Social Security, books on speedy trial, books on stare decisis, that means leaves the decision that stands. And let's see what else they have. Sanctions, securities law, opinion writing and publication, patent law, local rules, long-range planning, magistrate judges, federal rules, federalism, history, employment discrimination. This is a federal judicial center. And it's located, hello Katie, at Thurgood Marshall Federal Judiciary Building, 1 Columbus Circle, Northeast, Washington, D.C., 20002. And the judge in charge of that is Raya Zoba. Raya W. Zobel. Well, let me disentangle myself here from Katie Kitten and come over and show you the picture. I wish I had the time to read these publications. Ah, it would be wonderful to have the time. Isn't that right, Katie Kitten? Isn't that right? You know why Katie Kitten's here? Because it's lunchtime. I would also like to read to you just a tiny bit from the 100th anniversary, New York Supreme Court, Appellate Division, 2nd Department. That's their court down there in Brooklyn at 45 Monroe Place in Brooklyn Heights. Just let me read you one or two things. Since they're from Brooklyn, we'll call them Oily. The first case that the court decided in 1896 was reported by Marcus T. Hun, H-U-N, and appears in the volume cited as First Appellate Division. It involved an action brought against the endorser of a promissory note on an appeal from what was then called the Kings County Circuit. When the Appellate Division, Second Department, was established, it was housed in a courtroom in Brooklyn's Borough Hall. The grandeur of the court's prior trappings may still be seen in Borough Hall's refurbished ceremonial courtroom. In 1938, the present courthouse opened its doors. It's still too dark, and it's still bad acoustics. The Appellate Division was conceived as a court that had the jurisdiction to provide review for the vast majority of cases, leaving the Court of Appeals free to declare and settle the law. History has violated that design in the ensuing 100 years, and so have their decisions have violated that design. The Appellate Division has heard a multitude of cases, both civil and criminal, under its broad power to review both legal and factual questions. During the first 100 years, the court has seen many milestones. Its first black justice was appointed in 1980, and its first woman justice was appointed in 1984. In April 1984, 84 I should have said, woman justice was appointed in 1984. In April 1994, a bench of the court was solely comprised of female justices. This was the first time this had occurred in an appellate court in the history of the state of New York. The court today, the Appellate Division, Second Department, today consists of 20 justices and is the busiest appellate court in the nation. Most of the justices are appointed from the 10 counties over which the court has jurisdiction. I've had 13 cases in this appellate court. Kings, Queens, Richmond, Nassau, Suffolk, Westchester, Putnam, Dutchess, Rockland, and Orange counties. The court hears appeals from the Supreme Court, and there's a lot of those because there are so many bad Supreme Court judges. Surrogate's Court, the Court of Claims, County Court, Family Court, and the appellate term. And next week, I will read to you this page, and these pages are unnumbered. This is Katie Kitten. Katie Kitten. NBC Television Network. That's about commercial integration, participating sponsorship agreement part two. It would be nice to be putting somebody on the NBC Television Network, but I don't have time to that because one, lawbreakers, two, lying lawyers, and three, inept judges. Oh yeah, the telecommunications bill. What do you think of that? And I guess that's all of the announcements for this week. I would like to make you aware of Americans for Legal Reform, Carl Lanciser and Harvey Cash out in Long Island, and panel on lawyers, First Kill the Secrecy. Well, they do, you know. What they do is crooked, and so naturally the next thing to do is cover it up. And they want you to write to Judith Kay. Just one paragraph about the telecommunications bill. It's hard to understand it, isn't it? Hard to find a city to free the exploding television, telephone, and home and computer industries to jump into each other's fields and reshape the culture and commerce of the 21st century. Is that so, Katie? Is that so? The bill, saluted by Senator Larry Pressler, Republican South Dakota, as a telecommunications roadmap into the new century, flew through the House 414-16, and then the Senate 91-5. Wow. This unleashes a digital free-for-all, said Representative Edward Markey, Democrat Massachusetts, who headed the telecommunications subcommittee until Democratic control ended last year. The results will be tens of thousands of new jobs. We're all going digital, and life will never be the same. President Clinton hailed the action, saying in a statement, consumers will receive the benefits of lower prices, better quality, and greater choices in their telephone and cable services, and they will continue to benefit from a diversity of voices and viewpoints in radio, television, and the print media. The president will sign the bill probably within a week, Vice President Al Gore said in a telephone interview. TCI isn't doing much for diversity by murdering public access. Pretty. Oh, you're such a pretty kitty. Peter says a husband is like wine. He gets better with age. And Dottie says, if I'd known that, I would have kept mine in the cellar. And the phone rang in the maternity ward. And an excited man said, this is Charles Patterson. My wife is having a baby. I'm bringing her over right away. And the nurse said, calm down. Is this your wife's first baby? He says, no, I told you, it's Charles Patterson. And the little boy says, Daddy, does the husband boss the house? And Daddy says, no, son, the husband houses the boss. We're going to close with a Bible passage. This is all of the reports on the law breaking for February 1st to February 8th. And the Bible passage is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved, through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Take care, folks. Stand up for your rights. Just the way Katie's going to stand up to get her lunch. And keep your courage flaming. Thank you, Dino. This is Cablevision file number 2. Number 1 is as big as this, a whole file drawer. And that's down in the archives in the basement. This is all Cablevision here. This is number 3. That goes way, way back into here. Isn't that awful? And it's all lies. It's all lies and it's all cover-ups by these lawbreakers. Now I'll show you Continental. So far, this is one file drawer. And let me go over here and show you TCI for you. That's TCI just starting out. They're about 700 pages. The file before that is Gelman. And this is only the last volume of it. The rest is in the cellar. On that, we are waiting for a decision from the appellate firm, the First Judicial District. Before Gelman, is Wall, the law breaking of Roberta Daniel, James Walsh, Theo and Ella Alpucci, and Kevin, and Andrew Larkin. And that's 3 volumes. The first one is the DHCR, which there's no time to attend to. They're totally inadequate and incompetent. It's unbelievable that the state of New York could have a bad record like the DHCR is giving it. And the second file is a new Wall lawsuit, which has been put on hold for 3 months. And after that is the last one of the Alpucci Larkin law breaking. That's the little Canon PC copier. This is a new Canon typewriter. I got one because Canon has been so good to me about my video camera. And this is a Smith Corona. And Franklin is sending out a letter to a man, an oral surgeon, who wanted to know about TV advertising. This is the converter box that I bought so that I wouldn't have to pay TCI $3 every month for rental of their converter box and never own it. This is the same crooked thing that the telephone company pulled, and we got rid of that. This is a cable customer's bill of rights. Franklin is just about to send out that happy book that you just heard requested. And guess what this is? Hey, cat. Hey, cat. Hey, cat. Hey, cat who usurps my lounging chair. A cat named Ginny. Today is February the 10th, 1996. Here are a few jobs, just a few, you know, like a dozen. What has to be done today? We have to bring Continental up to date, file paginate, log and mail. We have to bring TCI up to date, file paginate, log and mail. We have to prepare. Date, file, paginate, log, and mail. We have to prepare for the Cablevision trial of March the 4th. And That's just a small list. There's about 600 jobs that have piled up. And it's really discouraging because you know that no matter how hard you work, and if you work every minute, you're still going to lose. At the end of the day, it's not going to be done. But that's because of lawbreakers and lawyers and cover-uppers. And it's because of crooked lawyers, and it's because of inept judges and a breakdown of the justice system. Everybody, this is a week of reports as to what happened from February the 9th, 1996 Friday to today, February the 15th, 1996 Thursday. These are reports on fights for rights. People will take away your rights any way that they can for their own selfish purposes. And it deals with their law breaking and with their lying and with their covering up. But we're going to start off with jokes. Nell said, or Nell's husband said to her, "Honey, you look the same as you did when I married you 15 years ago." And she said, "I should, I'm wearing the same dress." And Alice and Arthur couldn't afford to go to Niagara Falls for their honeymoon, so they went to the car wash instead. And Charlene was married four different times. First she married a banker, and then she married an actor, and then she married a minister, and then she married an undertaker. So that's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go. We're going to report to you on the law breaking of Roberta, James, and Daniel Walsh, and Nella, and Theo Alpucci, and Andrew and Kevin Larkin. Everything's up to date here as far as the courts go. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for the Appellate Division, Second Department, for an oral argument on Glendora's appeal of the atrocious Judge Harold Wood decision. Totally incompetent. And that is waiting for it to be calendared, and it'll probably be 8 months. So if this is February, then it'll probably be October, an oral argument. We are waiting for Bruce Bendish to submit respondent's brief for Walsh and Alpucci, and I doubt very much that he will ever do that. And that'll probably take 9 months for that to be calendared, and so that might be argued orally in Brooklyn in November. We are happy to report that the Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin log got out, and we can come over there and we can show you the stats. The time they took this week of our lives was 4 hours. The money they took was zero. The tortious acts are up to 3,241. They have volume 34, bad record, and page 3,873. And this is exhibit 91, and it's mailing number 217. The guest of Roberta blasted her horn. That's four laws broken by two people, eight tortious acts, and that person parked across the sidewalk, thus making pedestrians going out into the street. Glendora shovels snow away from the front door area. We have Roberta's cigarette butts all over the front door area. The Glendora parking space is clear. Daniel Walsh plowed his red truck under the shrubbery. That's three laws broken. And this is his neurotic, demented, and mean-spirited law-breaking. And on February the 10th, Saturday, cars drive in here that don't belong in here. As I say, people will take away your rights. And G93OXM blew the horn six times because That car couldn't get into its parking place. The telephone books, instead of being distributed to buildings A, B, C, and D, were all left in the front, the vestibule of building A. So this place having no superintendent because the landlord is too greedy to have a superintendent. He'd rather have the $1,000 a month rent. He has a $16,000 complex here, and he has no superintendent. And so Franklin and Glendora took those telephone books and distributed them, four to building C, four to building B, and there's one left over for building B. We found out that in building B, the curtain was missing. Cesar and Leslie have done a wonderful job painting the hallways all the way from the top of the second floor down to the first floor. And they just look beautiful. The Benjamin Moore paint is beautiful. Anyway, they had put the curtain in my locker without asking me to do it, but it was certainly clear that's what they wanted done after it dried when we put up the curtain in building B. Well, we did. And ignorant Ferdinand Alpucci came in and said, "What are you doing here?" And he has quite an accent. And he was rude and he was truculent, but we did not answer. And we just continued doing the good deed. And he continued trying to make a fight. And he says, "Stay in your own building, mind your own business. What are you doing here?" And again, we did not answer. We should have just left the curtain there, right? No. No, we won't stoop at his level. We continued the job. And I say that's grounds for eviction. There was no need of that. At 5:15 a.m. Sunday, we had no hot water, and I had a cold bath. At 5:15 a.m., and called Porzio, and I called Regent Oil. The laundry at 6:20, though, the water was hot. The cellar is a mess. There's a sofa that's been abandoned there. You see what I mean about people taking away your rights for their own selfish purposes? There's a bookcase there. There's a pool table there. This is all junk. It all should have been thrown out instead of dumped in the cellar. Cesar ladder is there, and all of his paint stuff is there. The minister in the sermon was talking about being a good neighbor. It was 50 degrees. Can you imagine that? On Sunday, 45 degrees, we washed the Lincoln for the first time in a couple of months, and it just shines. It looks like it's from a showroom floor, and it is 16 years old. What is 1979? Yeah. And, it's 213,000 miles. Franklin had lube, oil, and filter. And at 50 degrees, the snow melted. Thank heaven for that. And Glendora picked up a bag of litter out of the field. That's the first one I picked up for this spring. They should print tax forms on Kleenex for those of us who have to pay through the nose. And I gave you the stats. Not bad. We're winning this fight slowly, gradually. Messages for Cesar to call Frank. He hasn't done it. He was here a little bit on Wednesday. He was here a little bit on Tuesday. But all of those jobs aren't done. And you know what jobs they are. Yeah. The cracked cellar window over the set tubs. Take out the sofa. Take out the bookcase. The light in the front hall outside of Glendora's door, 2A door. Telephone books to building B, C, and D. He didn't do that. We did. Paint Glendora's living room. He came in with he did a very, very good job. There were some leaks from radiators or plants upstairs, and he just scraped it all down. Everything he does is so well when he ever gets around to do it. No heat in the radiator southeast. I think we took care of that. No heat in the radiator of the bathroom. And the kitchen threshold board has kicked up and should be replaced, and close the storm window in the living room. Okay, he did that. So he's only got 5 things to do. Now, the thing that caused the no hot water at 5 o'clock every morning, it was okay up until about 5 days ago. It was a motor. And Bob Pepe was here, and Mark put in a new motor. And the temperature got down to 6 degrees. Then it was 13 degrees for a while. And I think that's all the news. Franklin Glendora served the subpoenas on Cablevision lawbreakers, the defendants, the Dolans, and Tata. And then we went to Manhattan Cable TV to hand in programs. So far it's been a week of peace. We had storm number 18 yesterday, 18 snowstorms this winter, and it was 5 inches. It was fluffy. It was very pretty, but it's a lot of work to shuffle it up. But a nice man came along and shoveled out my parking space at 1:20 p.m. And we had an intruder this morning. People come into this driveway. They don't belong in this driveway. They don't have a parking place in this driveway. They don't live here. And they crowd themselves between the driveway and between our southeast window and the field. And usually they blow horns. As I say, people who take away your rights for their own selfish purposes. This morning at 7:07 a.m., J65BAS was in here for about 20 minutes. And that completes the report on Wall, Alpucci, and Larkin for this week. And today is February 15, 1990. This is the work I have to face all day, every day, on Glendora versus the Cablevision lawbreakers. That would be Charles Dolan and John Tata, William Quinn, and all those other names I hope that are up there on the screen. I use constantly, not as much as I would like to because I can't get to it, the Federal Judicial Center. I would love to read this book. The Federal Appellate Judiciary in the 21st Center. The Federal Judicial Center is run by the government of the United States. The judge in charge of it right now is Judge Zobel, Z-O-B-E-L. And here's one I'd love to read. Summary judgment practice in 3 district courts. And the 1994 annual report of the Federal Judicial Center. And folks, they just have so many books on the courts and practice and on judges and on lawyers that I would love to read it. Here's somebody's picture in here. Let's see if it's anybody we know. Gordon Vermont, Ted Coleman, James B. Eaglin, and William B. Eldridge. Director of the Research Division. They look like they were pretty smart, so they'd done a lot of reading. Although just 2 of them are wearing glasses. So I want to tell you again, the Federal Judicial Center, and they're at in Washington, D.C. If you want their address, you call me up. Summary judgment practice in 3 district courts. Now, the Cablevision log got out. Here is my, here's the reading that I would like to do. And I never get a chance, so I'm not very well read. I'm always running to court, or always refuting some lie that some lawyer is writing, or refuting some law breaking of some person. Like the Cablevision gang. But I am happy to report that the log did go out. It went out Monday, and here's the stats on Cablevision for the first week of February. 36 3/4 hours, $4.76, and that 4-part mailing that I read to you last week about the Judge Fox, what a bad job he did on depositions and what a bad job he did on February 2nd, Groundhog Day. I told you, with a temper like that, he shouldn't be a judge, he should be a hockey player. And then a notice of motion and a motion went out. And that was went out on this past Monday, February the 12th, Lincoln's birthday, when people are loafing. It's not bad enough, you know, to loaf on Lincoln's birthday, but because George Washington's birthday came on a Monday too, people will say, we'll pick that off too. The Japanese are right about Americans. We are loafers. We do not do our jobs. And that federal courthouse, as I told you, it closes down at the first snowflake with no regard to the public who has to get the work done. With no regard to themselves, they don't get their work done. And this is why. They're always loafing. Glendora TV log starting for the week of February 12th. This motion went out on February 12th. That would be the first legal paper and only legal paper to read you this week. The big news is to be working on the trial preparation. The trial is February 4th. These crooked cable operators are finally being brought to justice. They're coming to court. And the case is won. Glendora has won the case in four courts. Glendora, it's time for Glendora to get her damages to be paid. And she's going to ask the jury for hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars. And this is the trial preparation book. So far, we have spent 34 hours preparing for the trial. The first page of it is the notice of the trial from the Judge Bryant Court. The second section is the subpoenas for these people to come to trial. And we spent all day Tuesday serving them. And next is the log. And I have to find the microphone cord here. I find the best way is a loose leaf notebook, because when you go to court, things move very fast and papers get always mixed up and you can't find anything. So the log. And then the next section, you certainly can't find anything upside down. The next section is the law. This is law 45 on subpoenas. And the next one is exhibits and documents. And this is a judge conference, Judge Bryant conference for tomorrow. This is the to-do list. And this is what to tell the jury. Every thought that comes along, you have to jot it because it'll never come along again. And this is the voir dire, questions for Judge Bryant to ask the jurors, prospective jurors. This is the reading other than the law. This is certainly uncomfortable. This is the issues. These are the issues. The issues, of course, are freedom of speech, color of state, and money damages. And here are the categories that I've just been reading to you. And here are notes from telephone conversations, people talking about it, and what they have to say. And this is the flyer that was handed out Tuesday, which we will read you. And this is the article on Mr. Ufoli, who is a Democrat in Nassau County, and the Nassau County Republicans are very powerful. And Mr. Ufoli is a brave man. Lou Ufoli is a brave man to buck them. But he's just what you need out there. He keeps a watchdog eye on them. And I talked to him this morning to ask him if he had heard or had any evidence of any of the Republicans putting pressure on Cablevision to take a chat with Glendora off of TV, because Glendora was reading their bad record, specifically that of James Picken, the Consumer Affairs Commissioner, and of Thomas Galata, who knew about it and didn't do anything about it. So that's the trial prepared book. And this is the investigation book. I've never been able to get out to Nassau County and investigate and talk to people. I'm sure I could turn up some information that would be very valuable for this court. was aghast that the United States District Court did such a bad job on discovery and letting Cablevision lie, postpone, procrastinate, dodge, evade, all of the discovery, the depositions, the interrogatories, the admissions, the inspections, and the documents. They supplied only one document, 3 pages long, Gargar to Aznar. And they took so long doing it that they gave Cablevision ample time to destroy all of the evidence. It's just unbelievable to me, it must be to you, that they have no file at all on Glendora. And isn't it just unbelievable to you that they have no documents anywhere that mention the name Glendora? Yeah. Shows you what kind of people they are. Not only do they break the law, then they go and lie about it, and then they go and pay the shareholders money to Calagy to lie about it for them professionally and sloppily, and then they cover up. That's what you're dealing with out there. So I'm looking at the log for so far this week. It would be the 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th today. The big news is that I was behind on my praying for 18 days, and in spite of the lawbreaking of Cablevision and others, I was able to make it all up. In fact, I'm ahead a day. So I think first we will deal with this motion, and this is a notice of motion for an order granting plaintiff Glendora relief on 8 counts. And it's to the Honorable Charles L. Bryant. We'll have to look him up and see what the L stands for. Let's see, Lewis Lawrence. It says, please take notice that upon the attached affidavit of Glendora, sworn to February 7, 1996, and upon all prior pleadings had herein, plaintiff Glendora will move this court at 300 Quaropus Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, on the 16th day of February. That's tomorrow. That's why I have to go to court. And he will rule on this. 1996 at 9:30 a.m. or soon thereafter, as plaintiff can be heard for an order. This came in just before the notice of, this went out just before the notice of select jury and trial submitted. And I think I've read this to you, because it says here it was submitted on February 7th. And this is part of a mailing. That's what's confusing, because you have already heard this. Thing that happened yesterday was Howie Breschen called me back, and he's the court stenographer, and he owns AM Court Reporting along with Carl Anderson, another court stenographer I know in the Westchester County Courthouse. And Howie charged $413 for the Thomas Gargar minutes, and Franklin sent him $400, and we asked if he could let us go with the $13, and he did. Isn't he nice? And also, Joe over in his office made a mistake and charged $50 over for the Aznara deposition minutes. And Joe kept sending us a bill, but yesterday Howie Breschen said that he would take care of that $50. The only minutes left to come are the minutes of the deposition of William J. Quinn, who is the president of Cablevision operations, and who makes about $1 million a year, according to the proxy statement. Message on Charles Dolan's answering machine at 1 Meteor Crossways, and told him about the trial that was coming up, and told him that she did not believe Calagy when Calagy said that Dolan says he knows nothing about this. And if he did say this, if Dolan did say it, then Glendora doesn't believe Dolan. Cablevision has got out its new public Nassau, that is. The others have all been sent in Yorktown, Port Harrison, and Yonkers have all been sent in. And there's one more to send in, and that's Nassau. And so it's very, Diane Bennett did a great job printing it up this year. It looks very, very fancy. So I got to read that and sign it and send it in. We've been working on the subpoenas, must be for over a period of a week. You go to the clerk, and the clerk gives you blank subpoenas, but the clerk signs them, and the clerk who hands them to you signs them, and then they put a court seal on it. And so we got 10 subpoenas, and you have to be very careful. Because one clerk will tell you one thing, another clerk will tell you another thing. And after a while, you'll find out which clerk knows what he's talking about. And so then you go back to that same clerk, because you can get some very, very bad information from clerks. But we couldn't do without clerks. They're wonderful people. They're fun people. They're pleasant people. And it's good to talk to them. So that was the thing, to get them and then to figure out how to make them out and to figure out to whom to give them. Now, this is subpoena to appear at trial and to bring documents. And so I will show you some of these. Here's one to William Quinn. Now, you have to give $40 a day to a person that you subpoena. And Franklin has to fill in the affidavit of service on the back and have the person sign that he received it. And then printed on the subpoena is Rule 45, which tells you about how a person's rights are protected when he's subpoenaed. And you have to pay $40 for every day, and you have to pay their mileage. And these people are coming from Long Island. That's 50 miles, and that's about $15. You get 30 cents a mile. And so with every one of these subpoenas, Franklin gave the person subpoenaed a $70 check, and that amounted to $700. Do you think court should be like this? I don't. Do you think court should be exclusive because of cost? Franklin sent out 10 of these, or he served 10 of these, and there you are, $700. And what does the subpoena say? Issued by the United States District Court, Southern District of New York, Glendora, plaintiff versus Cablevision Systems Corporation et al., defendants, subpoena in a civil case, 93 Civ 8344, Charles L. Bryant, and Thomas Gardner, Cablevision Systems Corporation, 1 Meteor Crossways, Woodbury, New York, 11797-516-364-8450. You are commanded to appear in the United States District Court at the place, date, and time specified below to testify in the above case. 300 Quaropa Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, 914-390-4100, Courtroom 218, date March the 4th, 1996, Monday, 9:38 to 5 p. And you are commanded to produce and permit inspection and copying of the following documents or objects at the place, date, and time specified below. List the documents or objects, any and all documents mentioning Glendora. And the 300 Quaropa Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, March 4th, 1996, Monday, 9:30 a.m. to 5 p.m., and is signed by James M. Parkinson. Cablevision Systems Corporation, 1 Meteor Crossways, Woodbury, New York, 11797, 516-364, 8450. You are commanded to appear in the United States District Court at the place, date, and time specified below to testify in the above case. 300 Quaropa Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, 914-390-4100, Courtroom 218, date March the 4th, 1996, Monday, 9:38 to 5 p.m. And you are commanded to produce and permit inspection and copying of the following documents or objects at the place, date, and time specified below. List the documents or objects, any and all documents mentioning Glendora. And the 300 Quaropa Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, March 4th, 1996, Monday, 9:30 a.m. to 5 p.m., and is signed by James M. Parkinson, who is the clerk, and by Patrick Moran. And this was dated on February 9th, 1996. To whom else did the other subpoenas go? Mr. Thomas Galata, County Supervisor, Nassau. Mr. James E. Picken, Commissioner of Consumer Affairs, Nassau. Mr. Philip Sweet, Investigator for the Department, Office of Consumer Affairs, Nassau. Mr. Bertram Patterson, who worked in Mr. Picken's office. Mr. John Tata, 8 Sherwood Gate, Oyster Bay, New York, 11771, or Cablevision Systems Corporation, 1 Meteor Crossways. Mr. James Dolan, who is the son of Charles Dolan and who is now the Chief Executive Officer of Cablevision. Mr. Patrick Dolan, another son of Mr. Charles Dolan. Mr. Thomas Garger, you saw that one. Mr. James Kofall, who I believe was fired by Mr. Dolan. This is a hypothesis. Mr. Dolan is out joyriding all over the world. He comes home, he finds 3 lawsuits sitting in front of him, one for $31 million, one for $181 million, and one for $298 million. And so he finds out that Mr. Kofall took Glendora's program off the TV 2 years ago, and he fired him. Now that is a hypothesis. That's hypothesis one. We also included with each subpoena and William Quinn the notice of jury selection and of trial. And on the back of each one, folks, we put the full caption so that each person served had the full caption. So Tuesday, I picked Franklin up at 1:10, and we went down the hutch and over the Fog's Neck Bridge and down the Clearview. And I forgot to say hello to Mr. Hickey. I wonder if he still is the manager of the Fog's Neck Bridge. And it was a really fast trip, and I always like to take the Northern State, Grand Central Parkway, Northern State, come to Willis Avenue, and go south on Willis Avenue to Mineola, and the first person served was Mr. Thomas Galata, the county supervisor of Nassau. Then we found a parking space. You have to live a clean life to find a parking space. And the next person served were at 160 Old Country Road, the Department of Consumer Affairs, and that was Mr. Pickett, who was never in, and Mr. Bert Patterson, and we think now that he works at 1 West Street, and we saw them tow away a car, by the way, at 1 West Street, and for Philip Sweet, who is retired and gone to Florida, 25 years to Button. And then we hurried to Woodbury, and we asked the police. We said we wanted to exercise our freedom of speech, First Amendment rights, that we wanted to protest outside of Cablevision, and we wanted to hand out leaflets. And so we got all their rules, and I guess there aren't any. And so we cleared that with them. And then we went to Cablevision, and it's just atrocious, you know, how those people break the law. They're so stupid about it. They don't even break the law with any finesse. They don't know the law, for one thing. They never knew the laws. They wouldn't have done what they did if they'd known the laws. And then Marge Balbert came out, and she said, I refuse to sign. Now, how stupid can you be? That came from that dumb Charles Forman. And so she didn't sign, and she wouldn't accept service for Kofal. Well, she has to accept for Kofal, because it's his last known business address. So she has to sign. But Cablevision, in his arrogance and his ignorance, gone on now for 2 years and a quarter, and so that's the way they act. And I would be so ashamed of myself that I wouldn't know enough to sign. Well, we had our witness, Mr. Carl Ancizera, and myself, and Franklin. So we all saw what they did. And so the paper was just left. You are served. Here's Kofal's paper. This is his last known business address. He's served. You are served with it. So, and then Franklin wanted to go to the men's room, and the receptionist, who was named Marie de Gregorio, wouldn't let him in the door. She called security, and the security man that read it wasn't Astorita, who's so good looking. In fact, he didn't show up at all. The security man went into the men's room with him and stayed there. And now what would they have done if I said I had to use the ladies' room? And then we went out onto the street, the three of us, and we started handing out flyers. And let me show you the flyers. The temperature with the wind chill and everything was down to about 0 degrees. Just a itty bit above zero. The wind was about 35 miles per hour, and it was cold. And there were all of these geese out there, folks. My goodness. All of these geese, there must have been 60 geese. And I had packed a lunch, and so I started giving them everything in our lunchbox, and they started refusing everything. They wouldn't eat oyster crackers. They ate the little round crackers that are like Ritz crackers, and they wouldn't eat peanuts. But they did eat the bread. We gave them all the bread we have. And where do those geese go at night when it's so cold? And they walk across the road, back and forth, and all the cars have to stop and wait for them to walk. And they're such big birds. Oh, they're big birds. And when they fly, they look just like an airplane. And when they come in for a landing, they look just like an airplane. And they honk, honk when they come, when they're going to land. It's like, I don't know how they do it without a control tower. And so they were very interesting, and we waited until the people started to come out from work, and then we handed out the flyers. We must have handed out 100 of them, and the flyer says, Glendora wants inside information. This applies to you, if you would attend. Inside information, how Cablevision defendants took our program off TV on November 12, 1993. If you have any inside information about this matter, will you please call this number, 914-949-9495. Should have a question mark. Your name will never be mentioned. If you saw anything or heard anything about Cablevision taking Glendora's program off TV, or about Cablevision and Glendora in any respect, please call Glendora. Against Cablevision Systems Corporation, Dolan Bell, Lusgarten, Randolph, Tata, Kofal, Asnara, Garger, and Quinn. Glendora's hypotheses are that a government or political official exerted pressure on a Cablevision person or persons to take her program off TV, excuse me, because Glendora was reading the bad but true record of said government or political officials every week on TV. And those bad records were of William Picken and Thomas Galata and Scott Lord and Dylan, the Nassau sheriff, and of Stephen Irais, who was an assistant, he's not the sheriff, excuse me, attorney general, I mean, district attorney, and an assistant district attorney named Stephen Irais, who did nothing for justice, and who just let Scott Lord get by again with his law breaking. And so these records were being read on TV, and these people didn't want their bad records to be on TV. They didn't want you to know them. And so they asked Cablevision, by my hypothesis, to take the program off TV. And Cablevision, in its unbelievable arrogance and ignorance did it. Right here in the middle, I have to tell you that I forgot to show you a picture of the check that we sent to John Porzio, the owner of these apartments. We have to pay another $28 every month for the furnace. The furnace cost him something like $37,000, and the Grand New York State Division of Housing and Community Renewal gives him permission to charge us $28, every one of us tenants, $28 a month to pay off for this furnace. And he's only making $16,000 a month. A couple of months, he could have paid it off. So anyway, the check went out today. I don't send it. He wants us to commingle it with the rent, but I won't do that. The rent is paid on the 1st, and then on the 15th, we send in the payment for the furnace. And so I wrote on the check that this is payment for a furnace that has broken down 36 times, leaving us without hot water and or heat. An anonymous telephone call, it was on the telephone answering machine, and a young man was saying that Bert Mason was a lawyer for 100 people that Cablevision had sued. And so I called up and I gave him my name and my number, the lawyer. Got the two Cablevision mailings, number 259, the log, and then number 260, that mailing. It was in four parts that was read to you 2 weeks ago. And Callagy, who is the lawyer for Cablevision and has lost in four courts against a pro se, lost the Joan Collins case. This is what News Deficient Gannett wrote about it. And here is what the New York Times wrote about it. Don't ever think you're getting the news when you read the local paper. In Buffalo, we had a good local paper. In Westchester, we don't. Lucille went to, that ends Cablevision report for what happened from February the 8th to today, February the 17th. Lucille went to the lawyer and she said she wanted a divorce. And the lawyer said, well, do you have a grudge? And she says, no, we have a carport. And the lawyer says, well, do you have grounds? And she says, about an acre and a half. And the lawyer said, does he beat you up? And she says, no, I'm up an hour and a half before he is every morning. The lawyer says, well, why do you want a divorce? And the woman says, we have a communications problem. And Annette says, folks, that marriage is a real grind. You get up in the morning, you make the beds, you wash the dishes, you take out the garbage, and 2 weeks later you have to do the same thing all over again. And the High School Symphony Orchestra has really improved. Now you can tell when they're through warming up. Time to work on the answer to the dumb Division of Housing and Community Renewal. They don't even understand what the complaint is. They don't do anything. They don't understand anything. I don't see how people can be so bad and so inept and be paid by...
On Michael Gelman, Glendora versus Michael Gelman, the case of a man who didn't have the ethics or the upbringing or the religion to return two of Glendora's videotapes, we are waiting for a decision from the appellate term First Judicial District. And the indication is that it takes them about a month. The oral argument was on February 5th. And I saw Callagy in the hall, and Callagy was picking the jury for the Joan Collins trial. And Callagy lost.
Now, I have something else to show you on Glendora versus the Fund for Ancient Courts. Here's a stack of work that has to be done, waiting for these urgencies and priorities to get done. And in here, this is really an urgency, is a respondent's brief at last for the lawbreakers, the Fund for Modern Courts, Elizabeth Hubbard, Alan Beck, Michelle Mayapath, and Edmund Purvis. And here,
10 months late, is their respondent's brief. And so Glendora has to send in her reply brief, and the court, after letting them go 10 months without sending in a respondent's brief, the court is only going to give Glendora 10 days to hand in a respondent's a reply brief. And they've lost the case in the Supreme Court because they abandoned it. They didn't do their work there. This, of course, is the Supreme Court, but it's the appellate division. So that's got to be done, and there goes another weekend. Another weekend ruined by some legal paper about some lawbreaker and some liar and some cover-upper. Get all of the lawsuits up to date over the last weekend. TCI is up to date, Continental is up to date, Cablevision is up to date, and you have to file, keep the files in order, and you have to paginate, and then you have to do the log, write down what happened, add up the hours, and add up the dollars they cost you, and then you have to make the mailing, send out a mailing, and keep the defendants up to date, so that they realize they're not getting away with this. And so I did have a chance to read some of the pro se book. Have you gone to Slotsky's Delicatessen, new delicatessen in White Plains, down near Sam Ash, down near the, on Mamaroneck? Paul Gluck is bought the franchise for that, and he used to work for UA Columbia back in the good old days before we had these lawbreakers that are now called TCI. So anyway, I got half of it read, folks. This is the pro se book that's put out by the United States District Court, and it tells you about all kinds of things. The pro se office, the cost of filing a lawsuit, the court system, jurisdiction and venue, how to do legal research, writing and filing a complaint, service of process. We don't have to do that one. How to file an answer. You ought to tell that to Ben Wiles and Robert Kellogg. Amended complaint, a motion practice, appointment of counsel, no way. Magistrate judges, bad. Discovery, bad. Courts do a bad job in discovery. Trial, preparation, appeals. And a glossary. Oh, it's a nice book. And when you're in form of properist, the pro se clerk gives you one of those books free. If you want to buy it, it costs $15. And this is file 8 we're going into of Continental, the law breaking of Amos Hostetter, and Nair, and DeLorme, and Ritter, and Nancy Hawthorne, and William T. Schleyer, and Continental Cablevision Incorporated, and Greg Sanders, and Douglas Guthrie, who was a fugitive, and, they're all fugitives, Diane Rainey, and Melissa Cooper, and American Cable Systems of New York, Inc. Defendants. The case number on that is 95-CIV-6814. Barrington D. Parker, the magistrate, is Judge Lisa Margaret Smith. I'll give you the stats in just a second. You know, freedom of speech, their law breaking has cost us on the 26th week, this thing's been going on for half a year, 348 and a half hours, $732.63, and for lawyers' fees of $250 an hour, multiplied by 348 and a half hours, Continental Lawbreakers, whose names you see on the screen, I hope, Old Glendora, $87,125 in lawyers' fees. This paper went out on Monday. Plaintiff protests dilatory court.
The report on continental law breaking is really short this week, the week of February 12th, from February the 8th to February the 12th. Glendora had a court date for February the 9th. 1996, sneakily it disappeared. There was no notice of same, there was no reason given. This should not happen in a court, there was no record of it. Mr. Walsh, too, has done nothing about settling the matter of Mr. Ritter. Mr. Ritter has defaulted and owes Glendora $298 million. Glendora has received no word on her order to show cause, affidavit, and memorandum of law why defendants should not be temporarily restrained and preliminarily enjoined from cutting her program down from every week to every other week or twice a month or whatever they did. It's not clear what they did. They don't know themselves what they did. This court is in violation of Judge Silverman's ruling of July the 28th, 1994, that Glendora has a statutory right to have her program on TV and it must be returned to TV. Discovery was supposed to start in the Judge Parker court October the 6th, 1995. It did not. Discovery should have started in the Judge Smith court November the 11th, 1995. It did not. But the court postponed it a second time to January 5th, 1996. Discovery was postponed to February the 9th. But the court ran away with the February 9th date surreptitiously. And now discovery is postponed until February 27th. Is this 1996 or 1997? Is this just, speedy, and inexpensive? This court has ignored the fugitive flight of defendant Douglas Guthrie. He is nowhere to be found. The court has not made the lawyer Walsh II provide the current address. This court has ignored for weeks plaintiff's request to make a motion for sanctions of defendants and their lawyer pursuant to this Rule 11 in wasting time and causing unnecessary expense and in delaying justice. Lawyer Walsh II hath not answered Judge Smith's report and recommendation to Judge Parker. It is in limbo. In fact, whatever happened to this court, it disappeared along with Guthrie and Ritter. This court is slower than molasses in January, and now that it is February, it is not moving any faster. February the 2th, 1996, Friday, Groundhog Day, Glendora had 3 half-hour programs on continental cablevision, edited and ready to be cablecast, news reports. They belong to the continental community. So Glendora called Diane Rainey to ask her if she could schedule 2 half-hour specials. TCI has done this for Glendora in the past, and so has Cablevision Nassau. Diane came to the phone and said she would ask Melissa if there were 2 half-hours available. Otherwise, Glendora would have to send the programs to Harrison, Port Chester, and that's not fair to that community, and it is not fair to deprive continental community of the news. Diane called back in 20 minutes. She scheduled the 2 specials for Tuesday, the 11th, 6 p.m., and Wednesday, the 13th, at 6:30 p.m. on channel 19/26. It's all in the flux of building the new system, the fiber optics. Glendora was grateful. Diane volunteered, I could probably do this every week. Glendora says, that would be wonderful, and I'm very interested in that, and could you drop me a letter? And Diane said she would. The time for all week, nobody picked up the phone. Then for all week, nobody picked up the phone at Continental. Glendora could not get back in touch with Diane to accomplish the offer. Glendora called Walsh II office to try to get Rainey's direct dial, and Amelia said, oh, we don't have that number. And Glendora says, you don't have the number? She's your client. Mr. Walsh has the number, and he isn't here. Glendora says, look it up in the file. Oh, Mr. Walsh has the file with him. I couldn't even carry my Continental file around with me. What has Glendora told Judge Smith before about the Walsh II office? Friday, February 9th, Glendora tried the Walsh II office to get the number again. Another woman said, we don't have the number, and even if we did, we won't give it out. Now that is 2 stupid things. And then she said it again, and Glendora says, well, that's 2 stupid things twice. She has nice hours, Diane Rainey. Glendora called on Friday at 4 p.m. and she had left for the day. Glendora left a message on Rainey's recorder. Glendora finally got the number. And Glendora didn't have time to call back the Walt's 2 number and give him the number, give the office the number. Oh, that is so dumb. And so last night I called. I'm trying to get a hold of Walt's 2 to notify him that Andrew D'Agostino left a message on Glendora's telephone answering machine that her order to show cause will be heard before Judge Parker on February the 21st at 4:30 p.m. And would I please notify the adversary? And you can't notify the adversary because the people, there's no telephone answering machine to leave a message on, and the people who answer the phone act so strangely. Glendora is sure that Judge Smith would like to see that Diane Rainey settlement that was offered on February 5th. Glendora versus Cablevision comes to trial in less than 3 weeks, March the 4th, 1996, 9 a.m. all day. Everybody's welcome. This is where Hostetter et al. Will be in 2 years from now, coming to trial. You're all invited to see the show. Remember, one lawyer wrote to another, "Sir, I regret to inform you our respective clients are in danger of agreement." See who play, Ray Gardet, Rainey, in the Gannett paper of February the 5th, 1996, Monday. This is about the TCI matter, breaking the law, one of the worst we've ever seen, if not the worst. But this is Rainey here, up here. And I'll read you that. "We have enough channel space," said Diane Rainey, Director of Government and Public Affairs for Continental Cablevision of New York, Inc., which already offers WRNN in most of its 47,000 subscribers, to most of, in central and northern Westchester County and part of Putnam County. "We have 4 systems-wide public access channels, plus educational and municipal access. So that's up to 6 channels, which is a lot of public access." Rainey said, "I don't think they'll ever be able to fill all of them over fiber optic lines. Something expanding them once they reschedule or once they reach a subscriber's decoder box." Well, it's interesting, folks. If Diane Rainey says they have all of those channels, then why did they cut our programs back from twice a week to every other week? If Diane Rainey says they have all of those channels, then why did they cut our programs back from twice a week to every other week? Well, where were we? Glendora wants defendants fined and jailed, punitive and compensatory damages, and she wants sanctions against them and their lawyer. This court, lawyer Walsh too, and everybody else have been silent about defendant summary judgment, which could not fly anyhow. This court, lawyer, and defendants have been silent on subscribers' outrage at no dollars and cents refund instead of the junk that they're offering. These are the refunds that Assemblyman Richard Brodsky got the subscribers of both Continental and TCI. IBM and Goodyear are going to merge so they can manufacture a computer that makes snap decisions. Glendora swears under penalty of perjury that she sent a true copy of this protest to lawyer Thomas E. Walsh too, as well as to all persons on the list on the next page. And that would be all of the defendants, folks, plus the two judges, and also other judges, Judge Grisey, Judge Bryant, Raya Zobel, the Federal Judicial Center, oh, that's a wonderful place, and Ralph Meekham, Administration U.S. Courts, Judge Walker, U.S. Court of Appeals Task Force on Bias Judges, and Richard Brodsky. Back to me with that letter. So you see, that was false. That was bad faith. No letter has been produced saying that she would do that, play three programs a week, or how many extras there were. And this is what happened with the defendants, Continental Cablevision, Timothy P. Nair, Amos B. Hostetter, Jr., Michael J. Ritter, Nancy Hawthorne, Jeffrey T. Glorum, William T. Schleyer, Continental Cablevision Incorporated, Greg Sanders, Douglas Guthrie, Diane Rainey, and Melissa Cooper, and American Cable Systems in New York Incorporated are the defendants, and Glendora is the plaintiff. The statistics as of the 26th week closing, as it did on Sunday, February the 11th, 350 hours, $741, and $87,500 of Continental's, Glendora, and lawyer's fees. Ask me who works for Continental if I would send up the reports on TCI. I'm more interested in what happens at TCI than in what happens at Continental. And a card in front of a neighbor's house was a sign that said, drum set for sale. On the lawn in front of the neighbor next door was a sign that said, hooray! And you know you're reaching middle age, folks, when you're faced with two temptations, and you'll take the one that gets you home at 9 p.m. And a midget fortune teller escaped from jail, and the headline in the newspaper was, small, medium, at large. Plain City Court that deposition that we received from Officer Stead was not satisfactory. It was nothing but a form, and any three-year-old could have filled it in. That back in the old days, we got a deposition from a police officer written out in hand telling us what happened. So I said it was unacceptable, and I wanted a real deposition. Every week, I read to you one page from this book, the 100th anniversary of the Appellate Division, Second Department. And so, as originally authorized by the Constitution of 1894, the Appellate Division, Second Department, was comprised of the justices and their staff. In 1925, the Constitution was amended to increase the number of justices from 5 to 7. And since then, the constitutional complement of justices has been augmented by special designation by the governor in this manner, the number of justices in the Second Department grew to 8 in the early 1960s and to 10 in the early 1970s. In 1976, there were 12 justices on the court. In 1977, there were 14. To make more efficient use of its judicial personnel in 1978, the court began sitting in panels of 4 rather than 5. In 1981, the number of justices was increased to 15, and that's because we have so many bad judges in the Westchester County Supreme Court. What they should do is get rid of the bad judges in the Westchester Supreme Court, and you wouldn't have to pay for all these additional justices in the appellate division. As of January 1994, in order to better address the court's burgeoning caseload, the complement of justices reached 20, consisting of the presiding justice, 6 associate justices, and 13 additional justices. This made the Second Department not only the busiest, but also one of the largest appellate courts in the nation, because the Westchester County courthouse has the worst judges in the nation. The justices come from various counties in the downstate area: Kings, Queens, Nassau, Suffolk, Richmond, Westchester, Orange, Dutchess, New York, and the Bronx. Only 3 justices have permanent chambers at the Brooklyn Courthouse. The remainder have temporary chambers. Many share offices at the Brooklyn Courthouse and permanent chambers in their home counties. These justices are available at their home chambers to attorneys in those counties. Assisting each of the 20 justices of the court is a law secretary, whose duties include legal research and the preparation of draft opinions. Judges don't make the decisions, the law clerks do, or interns. Each justice also employs the services of a confidential secretary, whose duties include calendar, case, and office management. This is a very fine pamphlet by Americans for a Better America. I like to read to you something from it every week. Currently, justice is a function of connections, too often limited to the wealthy and to those within the system who can manipulate it in their favor. It's a closed system functioning as an entire industry in and of itself. Decisions are often based on what is most beneficial to lawyers and judges, with judges being business agents for lawyers and lawyers supporting these judges, all at the expense of and detriment to you, the public. This is judicial corruption. Justice should be fair, equal, and not be a function of prejudice, bias, or financial benefit to those in the judicial system. Amen. This item that TV anchor, WNBC TV Chuck Scarborough, gave $1,000 to Steve Forbes, and he attended a fundraising dinner. He declined to comment. A newsman declined to comment. He's 52 years old, and he won't be able to cover any political campaign stories in 1996. Firsthand, he can report on them on TV as the news comes in. About Warren Buffett, the man who used to own a part of ABC, Cap Cities. He owns Berkshire Hathaway, and his father was an astute investor, and the son is certainly, I guess he was the richest, named the richest person in America. Anyway, the new shares will not exactly be cheap. They will be almost equivalent to a 30th of a share of existing Berkshire stock, with the old shares closing yesterday. A share of Berkshire Hathaway costs $31,700. Now, that's quite a lot of money for one share. And it was down $200. And that the new shares that he's going to offer are about $1,000. There are some things that money won't buy. Poverty. You need credit cards for that. And the father kept saying to his son, you got to learn from the mistakes of others. You just don't have time to make them all yourself. And poverty is hereditary. You get it from your children. The new administrative judge of the New York court system is Jonathan Lippman, and he comes from Rye Brook. He's the chief administrative judge, and he's been with us since January 1st, and he succeeds Judge Elio Melonis, whom you and I have talked about several times. And Lippman is 50, and I saw him speak at the Appellate Division, Second Department, 100th anniversary. This is the check that was sent to Porzio, $28 for the furnace, which has broken down 36 times, leaving us without heat and or hot water. I'd love to do this healthful recipe, but keeping up with these lawbreakers and their liars, their paid liars, the lawyers, and but I would love to make a rich and green entree. Unpolished rice, cooked chopped spinach, cooked red onion, cooked non-fat cottage cheese, chopped unfat, non-fat cottage cheese. I don't think I'll go for that though. Equal amounts of crackers and soy sauce or Vegix, and one can of mushroom soup on top of the sauce. Heat and serve. It can serve any size as desired. Americans for Legal Reform, that's Carl Antazer and Harvey Cash in Long Island. They want to get the secrecy out of the hearings of lawyers who have been charged with crimes. And I don't think I can read this, so small. That recommendation comes as a relief to some in the legal profession who are worried that the panel was going to suggest opening up the entire proceeding to the public from the time the complaint is filed to the time the lawyer is sanctioned. That it comes as a disappointment to other groups hoping that New York would follow the lead of states like Oregon, where the whole process is public. Well, it should be. So write to Judith Kay, folks, please, and complain. She's our chief judge in the state of New York. This is the receipt for my converter box. TCI charges you $3 a month or so for a converter box, and you never own it. And this is the same crooked thing that the telephone company pulled for years and years and years until people got smart and started buying their own telephone instruments. And then you own it. So that's a ripoff. Here is a brochure from the Church in the Highlands, compiled by Everett Parker, about being such a loving and kind church. I will say that I have yet to witness that. The Views from the Pews is on Channel 8, in large part because Glendora sued them and has spent 800 hours suing them, or whatever it is. I'll have the stats for you in a minute. And not one person at the Church of the Highlands has ever expressed any appreciation of that fact. Here is a cellular telephone. They're getting to be quite the thing, aren't they? And this is from the New York Tenants Association. We have to support the tenants because of the greedy landlords. And they're going to have this tenants' right and organizing conference on March the 2nd and 3rd from at 125 Barclay Street in Lower Manhattan. So tenants, go. Glendora's backlog on the 5:30 to 6:30, meditate, create, and the think drawer, and exercise. And letters got to 18 days behind, and it got made up. And Franklin's is 23 days behind. That's because we have to stop our life and fight for our rights. Because the lawbreakers, such as TCI,
And because of the people they hire to lie for them, those are called lawyers, and because of their covering up. This is what happened on TCI, Telecommunications Incorporated, John Malone, Robert Magnus, from February the 8th to today, February the 15th, to the chambers of the Honorable William C. Connor, Senior Judge, United States District Court, Southern District of New York, 300 Quaropus Street, White Plains, New York, Glendora versus Malone, Magnus, TCI et al. Plaintiff Glendora wishes to make a motion for default judgment pursuant to Rule 55, a motion for relief from judgment or order pursuant to Rule 60B6, and a motion for other relief on six counts. This is a letter requesting permission to make these motions as per your rule. A litigant should be able to make motions without permission. That is why we go to court. Defendants have 3 business days to rebut. Could there be a conference of record 3 days after Glendora receives defendant's answer? Glendora's motions are attached herewith. Yours in truth, Glendora, and a copy to Ben Wiles. And this is Glendora versus John C. Malone, Bob Magnus, Telecommunications Incorporated, Robert Thompson, Brendan Clouston, Barry Marshall, Donnie A. Fisher, John W. Gallivan, Kim Magnus, Robert F. Nathy, Paul J. O'Brien, Brian Sullivan, Scott Brown, Mary Magarelli, John Wicker, Nona Carey Dunn, Miles Rich, and any John or Jane Doe defendants may claim as a necessary party, and UA Columbia Cablevision of Westchester Incorporated, DBA TCI Cable of Westchester. Plaintiff's notice of motion. Minutes we talked to him on the phone. Did I mention that to Judge Bryan? I think I did mention I needed time to go out there and investigate and time to read the file, which is 32 volumes, and also missed was how much can Glendora assume Judge Fox knows about the case. Yours in truth, Glendora. And Franklin's report you read, or rather I read to you last week. And so now what's going on? At the Pearl Harbor Conference, Judge Fox said that he would get to us later as to how the deposition of Thomas Garger, December 27th, would be taken, by stenographers or by an audio tape. All right, so comes Monday this week, which was December 18th, Tuesday the 19th, Wednesday the 20th. Judge Fox hasn't got back to us as to how that deposition is going to be taken. And you've got to get in touch with a court stenographer. You can't call up the next day or the day before and say, I want a court stenographer. It takes time to get a court stenographer. That's another bad thing about it. It takes no time to put an audio tape in a cassette player and a recorder. And so I called and I asked Mary Alice to ask Judge Judge Fox, if he was going to let me take that by audio tape, which is my right pursuant to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 30B2. It can be audio tape. And she says, well, you have to put that in writing. And I said, I don't think so. I think that's cumbersome. And you let the minutes that I paid $424 and that I rushed to get to you sit in the box for 24 hours and I go to court and you don't even have the minutes yet because you can't go down 2 floors and pick up what's in the mailbox? And I said it was burdensome. But I'd had to do it.
And so I wrote it out. So, let me show it to you. Katie feels a little more secure being up here with you. Dear Judge Fox, on Pearl Harbor Day, 4:40 p.m., you said you would determine in what way the Glendora deposition of Thomas Garger would be taken on December 22nd, 7th, 1995, Wednesday at 2 p.m., after you examined Charles Former. Glendora hopes you will let it be audiotaped, which is her right, pursuant to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 30B2. She has no money to pay for stenography.